Hello and welcome. So we're going to do a bit of programming, and I wanted to tackle the Espressif IDF. I've been using it for quite a long time now, actually. Not many videos out there on how to sort of use it, particularly in a C++ context. The IDF itself is written in C. But I'm I prefer C++. That's what I do for my day job anyway. And so for those of you who are wanting to move away from the Arduino style environment for programming your ESPs and not using the other things out there, ESP Home, Tasmota or whatever, you want to do your own sort of coding, whether it's learning or you've got a specific need that those other environments don't cover, then this should hopefully get you off and running. So I'm going to be using VS Code at the moment. Yeah, it's my preferred editor actually. I think it's more than anything just a bit easier on the eyes. It certainly shows up on computer screens and if you Chromecast into your TV or whatever, bit better than having a white background, and it's just nice and easier to read. And of course I've got this zoomed in. This looks horrendous on my computer at the moment. It's but it's zoomed in enough so that you guys can see it if you're watching it on a Chromecast on your telly or whatever. And so let's get started. So as you can see, this is my folder that we're in at the moment. So I'm just in an other random folder on my computer. Definitely make sure that it is not nested too deep. So what do I mean by that? You can see now that's not going to be zoomed in, but I'll read that out to you. E colon backslash Simon document slash code slash folder. Make sure that path isn't too long. If it gets too long, it's actually a limitation in Windows. If you're in Linux, you might be all right actually. But in Windows, if that path gets too long, the it just craps out on. So when you try and build, you start getting loads of errors that it can't find files. It's actually because there's too many characters in that path, and it truncates it. And then it can't find the file. So don't have that mess. Have your base folder nested too deep. SDK config. So this is pretty much your basic configuration that you get up and running to configure the chip. In VS Code, if you're using the Espressif extension, which I highly recommend, it can be a bit clunky to install. But basically, once you've sort of shouted at it enough and got it working, and you can build a basic project, then you don't really need to change it. I've reinstalled this a few times over the past couple of weeks, and it's considerably better than it was, well, even just a few weeks ago, certainly a couple of years ago. Well, it didn't exist then, but. So yeah, highly recommend this. Oh, the reason I reinstalled it is because I was having to write a guide on how to install it, and I wanted to make sure that I was actually talking some sort of sense. So I didn't need to reinstall it. It was because, you know, I wanted to go through the process and see how it's changed. See, it's still in preview, so it is still improving. But yeah, on the whole, it's not too bad. I'm on the IDF version 4.1 at the moment on the release. Been using that for quite a while now. It seems reasonably stable. There's a few things it can't do or says it can do but doesn't because it's buggy. You can have a look through that GitHub on that. A lot of it relates towards audio side of things, but it's not going to affect us today. So what we're going to do today then is just basically get a hello world up and running, just to make sure that everything's working and get all the configuration, because that can be the biggest battle of all, really, is just to get something out. And once you're able to flash a device and verify that it's doing what you want it to do, then the rest of it is just an exercise in code. So as you can see, there's not a lot in this base directory at the moment. There's a .vs code folder that's just sort of default with VS Code. That's where it puts all your settings and whatnot in that are set towards what your preferences are. So it's got my zoom level for this recording and so on. A Git ignore. So if you are using Git, I definitely recommend sticking build/ in there. Otherwise, each time you build it, when you then commit, if you could do a commit all, an add all, it'll put all the build files up. It just gets silly. You don't need it. And yeah, there's a few other bits and bobs in there. And yet the SDK config, you can either use their command line tool to do idf.py space, menu config, that's it. Or if you're in VS Code, you can click the little cog wheel here. And it's going to throw an error at the moment because I've not actually configured my environment just yet. I've just copied and pasted this over from another project, but we'll get into that in a bit. So first of all, let's get ourselves set up. I'm going to show you the way I like to structure my folders and stuff. So let's do that. So first of all, I'm going to have a core folder. That's where my main is going to live and not a lot else. And then I'm going to have my application folder. Oh, if I can type application, yes, folder, which is where all the interesting stuff's going to happen. And we'll get into the nitty gritty of that. In my core folder, I'm going to have an ink. And I'm going to have a source. You can put this as to whatever you like, but you'll need to follow a few steps that we'll get into a bit later when we come to do the CMake setup and config, because by default the IDF wants you to have a slightly different folder structure. I'm doing it the way I like it and showing you how to configure it for that. You can use the default if you prefer, but if you've got your own folder structure, you can follow this exact same schema, obviously with your structure, and you'll see how to configure that yourself. So very basically, in ink, we're going to have a main.h. Oh, my days, can't type today. There we go. And we're going to have a main.cpp. You can use HPP if you prefer. It doesn't actually matter for the build environment, but I'm just sticking to what I know. And right, okay, so very basically then, let's set up our usual shebang. So include, and we're going to include main.h. Oops. And we're probably going to want to do some logging. So we're going to do a hash include esp-log.h. And I'm going to set a log tag. I'm going to just do this as a hash define, the old C way. And that is going to simply read main. So hopefully you're familiar with hash defines. Basically, wherever in the code it sees, or in this compilation unit, should I say, this file, it sees the word log tag like that, it will just replace it with quote main quote. That's all we're doing there. And it's also useful to define a log, a local log level, when you, or before you include esp-log.h. So we're going to do that. So it's going to be a define log level local, and then esp-log, and we'll do verbose for now. This is predefined. Once you get your build environment set up and it's actually built something, you'll be able to hit an F12 in here. I've sort of cheated a little bit. This probably won't work for you until you build for the first time, but you can see it's just an enum, And these are the different levels, and I'll tell you about what those mean later down the line. And this is C++. So we need a main function. And actually, in the ESP build environment, it's not called main, it's called app_main. They have their own internal main function that you don't want to overwrite. And then that calls app main. It's because of all the FreeRTOS integrations and whatever. So the sort of definition for that is void app main. Oh, we've got caps on. App main. Oh, I hate this keyboard. And we'll do it properly like that. Now this won't work for the very simple reason that this is a C++ file, and the FreeRTOS and the ESP-IDF is looking for an app main function to call. It won't find this because the C++ is name mangling. So we need to link this to C. And the way we tell the compiler to do that is very simply extern C like that before. And if you look for that on Google, Stack Overflow, whatever, you'll see that that's the way to do it. Okay, so very simply then, what are we going to do in our main? Well, let's do a log. A log message, so let's use the ESP log and let's do I for log info. We're going to use our log tag and hello world, and don't forget your semicolon. So log tag, you can see there it's a hash define, which we've done up here. So all it's doing is changing that to main like that. It just goes through and copies and pastes all the way through your code. Hopefully you're familiar with defines. And we're going to log this message as an information message, so it should show up green in if you're using an ANSI terminal. If you're using VS Code, you will be. And it will print that message and then return. Now, you don't want to return from this. If you return from this, bad things happen, and that's the end of your code. So we need to stop it doing that, because we don't want to just run this once. And quite simply, easy way of doing that is let's make it a while true. Now, that as it is going to go at a million miles an hour, and really spam the terminal window, probably crash your serial port if you're on Windows, because it just can't hack that data rate. So we're going to put a bit of a delay in here. Since we're using FreeRTOS, or because the IDF uses FreeRTOS, we can use some of those tools. And we can do, let's just pause for 100 ticks. So this is in ticks, not in milliseconds, which can be a bit of a pain. So ticks are, yeah, well, Google it. But at the moment, we've not actually included FreeRTOS into this. So VTAS delay, this function provided by FreeRTOS doesn't actually exist at the moment. So what we're going to do is stick that in the header. And queue all the comments on whether you should use define guards or pragma once, whatever. I've never had a problem with pragma once, so I'm just sticking with it. And we're going to include the FreeRTOS header. FreeRTOS.h, there we go. I should use autocomplete more regularly. So we'll save that file. So now VTAS delay should work absolutely fine here. Or actually, is VTAS delay in the task header. Funny feeling it is. Yes, it is. So you have to include, when you do FreeRTOS stuff, you have to include FreeRTOS.h first. And then the VTAS delay is in. I think you can actually skip this bit now. I think they've patched that out. Is in the task header. If memory serves me right. So that's our simple program. It will automatically, or the IDF will automatically pick up our app main, even though it's written in C++, because we've got this extern C identifier here. And then we're going to sit in this while true loop. We're going to print hello world as an information message, so it'll come up green with the tag main, and then we'll delay for 1,000 ticks, however long that may be. Now we want to get this to compile. The way we do that, or the way the IDF does it, to be more specific, is using CMake. So we need to tell CMake, or give it some information, and tell it how to build the projects. And that is done with CMakeList.txt. And this is where we stick our basic information. Notice it's in, and I've done that correctly. Yes, I have. It's in the root of the folder. That's important. It must be in the root for this particular CMake lists.txt. And you can do various different bits and bobs in here. So we're going to be doing things to a C++17 standard, so CMake CXX standard, and then C++17, and that will set CMake into a C++17 version thing. Now, C++17 only existed in CMake from version 3.8, so just to save a bit of headache later down the line, we can actually tell CMake of any version that when you try and compile this, there is a minimum version of itself required to actually compile this project. Came a gutser to this the other day when I actually got all this set up on a Chromebook, which ships with, the Linux distro on there, Linux Penguin actually, only had version 3.5, which did not have C++17, so it just started spamming a load of errors on it. Easy way to do that and save yourself some headache in the future is CMake minimum required, and then version. Caps are important in all of this, by the way, in this particular file, 3.8. So that's the first thing CMake will hit when it tries to build this project, and if its own version is not 3.8 or above, then it will throw a useful error message saying you need to update your CMake. Then we're going to set to C++17 standard. Now, this is the important line. If you are not using the default folder and file structure, hierarchy, whatever you want to call it, that is hard-coded into the IDF, or, well, more importantly, into this CMake, actually. But that lives within the IDF, their configuration. So we need to set some extra component directories. And we need to set our two folders. So we need application and we need core. Oh, not car, core. Oops, wrong button. There we go. That is going to tell CMake right at the start of the whole thing that, along with looking for the usual main folder and whatever is default in the IDF, I also need to look for a folder called core and a folder called application. And I'll include those in the build process. And that's what we've got here. And control B. And then for the IDF, we also need to include a IDF CMake file. So that is an include. And since we have got everything set up as per the IDF tools setup on the Espressif website, if you follow all of that, this you know, should be trivial. Follow their guide. I'm not going to go through it because basically it's documented really well. So that just pulls the IDF path from, in this case, I'm on Windows today. So the Windows environment variable IDF path. And then it's in the tools folder, in the CMake folder, and the file is called project.cmake. And that's what we need to include for, and what basically what this line does is it includes this project.cmake file, which in itself includes all the IDF stuff. So everything we're going to want from the IDF, all its libraries and APIs and so on and so forth, that's where that comes into our project. And then we're going to give our project a name. Oh my god, project, excuse me. And we'll call it our YouTube. Why not? You'll see where this pops up. It's not hugely relevant, to be perfectly honest with you. So that is our base, our root, if you prefer, cmakelist.txt. And that is what, when we hit build, this is the file that gets passed by cmake first of all, and then from there we go through and tell it everything else. So at the moment we don't have anything in application, so we're not going to even bother doing anything there. It'll look for that folder, it'll see there's nothing interesting in it, and just move on. But there is some stuff in core. Now CMake will look at core and go, nope, there's nothing in it. Well, there is, but there isn't a CMake list.txt. That's what it's looking for. So we need to add a file in here, cmake lists.txt in here. Now it's going to see this file and go, ooh, excellent, I need to look at something in here. Make sure it's not in the ink or source, but it's in this folder core. More importantly, it's in this folder that we put as in a set extra component directories. Okay. And we need to set some sources. So let's do that. So we're going to set sources. So this just sets a variable that we have decided to call sources in this instance. And it's going to be in the source folder. So dot slash just tells it the current folder we're in. And then slash source src. And then main.cpp, which is this file here. You don't necessarily have to do that, but you'll see later down the line when we actually start having application folders that have got multiple source files in, it's just nice to do that because it makes this next line a little bit cleaner. And this is the IDF component register. IDF component register. Keyword is sources. And then what are our sources? Well, our sources are all our CPP files and C files if we've got C as well. And we've actually given it a variable name here. So rather than keying in .source/main.cpp, all we can do here is use the $, squiggly brackets, and that variable name, which was sources. Let me just get rid of that for you. We're also going to have an include dir. Include directories. We want to include the current directory we're in, and we want to include that inc folder here, and that's how it's going to find main.h. Now at the moment we do actually have something in our main.h that CMake needs to be able to find, which is the FreeRTOS stuff. And also in our main CPP, we also need to be able to find this function, which is the ESP logging stuff. So we can do that by doing requires, because both of these two things, FreeRTOS and the ESP logging stuff, are actually a component in the IDF, rather than just a bunch of files. So they are already compiled as a CMake component. So we can add that in, and the component is simply called what the folder is called in the IDF, which is FreeRTOS. And the easy way to get the logging stuff in, and a few other bits and bobs as well, is just to include ESP common. So this is telling CMake we want to compile. And we want to compile sources that are this sources keyword. So at the moment, it's just main.cpp. We've got some include directories. So the include folder, that's where main.h is. And we also need FreeRTOS and ESP common to have been compiled in order for our stuff to work for the linker. So that's where it can get your VTAS delay in this case, and our ESP logging stuff here. So we'll save that. And that is pretty much all we need. And I am actually going to just comment that out for the moment, because I'm anticipating an error. And let's see what happens. And we'll go to the terminal. Here you can see all the components. TCP transport, SPI flash, blah, blah, blah. Okay, brilliant. Good. So we've got some problemos. Cannot find the file specified. Now that I've got a funny feeling is because Windows has balked one of my paths again. It's just changed one of my paths, so it's including the wrong thing again. But anyway, that's only a warning, it's not an error. So although I will fix that between episodes, it's not a problemo. Python 3, that's quite important, by the way. There's your list of components. I'm trying to find system cannot find the file path specified. Have I made a boo-boo? .source.main.cpp. .source.main.cpp. That's correct. Env. IDF path. Tools. CMake. Project.cmake. That looks right, so it's not noticed that file's changed at all. Oh. You div. You absolute div. I went and made a boo-boo. I knew it was a copy and paste error somewhere. I just knew it. It had to be. It, hang on. Terminal. Compile. Alright, VS Code's just crapped out for me, so let's do it the old way. There we go. Right. Let's get this back into C++ land. Didn't need to do that, but it helps me find it anyway. Oh, crikey, sorry, ears. My bad. So this should build, he says, with much more confidence this time. And let's do -p com 3 hours on flash monitor. Hey, huzzah! Hello world. That's going to pause for 1,000 ticks, however long that is. Oh, which was about there. And let's get rid of that then. Cool. Now, 1,000 ticks is... well, I don't know. However long 1,000 ticks is, 160 megahertz. It would be much more useful to have that in milliseconds or something similar. So let me just pull up something that will be handy for that. And that's not the file I wanted. Let's have a look at my Wi-Fi. Oh yeah, PDMS statistics. So we'll define here a second as, and this is a FreeRTOS function, milliseconds to ticks, and 1,000 milliseconds is a second. So PD second, wherever it sees that, it'll replace it with it. So just a nice little keyword to have. That I quite like. So if we put that in there, now it's going to delay for a second. Now, is VS Code going to build this? No, it's not. Oh, hang on. Let's get rid of that one. Tell you what, let's just get rid of all of that. Try again. Cannot find the file. Specified. Right, this is a VS Code thing. Workspace root. Has something changed? Is double slash a comment in JSON? I don't know. We're about to find out. So let's just get rid of that, that it just seems to be having an issue with. Let's try again. Really not liking this, is it? This is a VS Code issue, because we've just seen from the command line we can flash it and do all the goodness. So tell you what, let's stick with that. Let's pull up the command line. Let's go to our all we're trying to do here is just prove that it pauses for a second. So we'll change directory and then we'll do. Has it saved my thing? No, it hasn't. It's annoying. IDF.py flash. Let's just do it the quick way. At flash. Oh, I might need to put the port in there. Oh no, found it. Hello world. Hello world. Hello world. Hello world. Hello world. Excellent. So that's roughly a second. In fact, we can see it's almost exactly a second. This is in milliseconds here. It's bang on. Quite impressed with that. That's good. Okay. Right. So we need to get this, well, we don't need to, but we're going to set this up, as I say, in C++ land. So it's all very well and good just having this main function here that does this, but really that's not how we do things in C++. So we're going to do a class. So if we go over to the header, let's define ourselves a class. It's not going to inherit anything yet. In fact, we'll make it default constructible and everything, so we don't have to worry about the rule of 3, 5, 6, whatever it is these days. But we're going to have an ESP error type returning function called setup, and then we will just have a void function that is our run. Tell you what, let's, because I'm anticipating a few people coming over from Arduino, let's call it loop. So we got this class now. Oh, we did a semicolon at the end of that. Awesome. And it makes sense to statically construct this. So that is exactly what we are going to do. And it could even be a, no, it can't be a comps expert, can it? Let's call it my main. So the compiler will allocate memory for this at compile time. And then what are we going to do with this? Well, we'll do my main dot setup, and then we'll do while true my main loop. Now, if setup fails, then there's no point going to the loop. There is a macro for that, Error check, I think. ESP error check. Yeah, it is. So what this basically does is if this returns anything but ESP OK, it will do an abort and just reboot reboot the processor. Jolly good. So now we need to define what these functions actually are. So we've got our main setup, which takes no parameters and is spelt slightly differently to that, which currently doesn't do anything. And then we've got our run function method, although it's statically allocated. So, and our run can just be this. Now this shouldn't do anything differently than before. And let's go for it first time and see what happens. Oh, there we go. No declaration max matches void main run. Oh, because I was doing Arduino land its loop, isn't it? No return statement in function returning non-void. Good point. At the moment, our setup doesn't actually do anything. I'll tell you what, let's make it do something. Semicolon. Every time. I got a new keyboard and yeah. So as we can see there, setup got called once, as we expect, and then it's looped into hello world. So this currently doesn't do anything different from before, except we've got this setup function. And as you can see now, if we just go to the editor, a bit easier to see on your screen. Class, so this proves we are absolutely in C++ land. Hope that was interesting. We'll move on next time, explore something a little bit more interesting, and do the next sort of typical starter project of let's make an LED blink. See you in the next one.